him to them. And when they heard it, they were glad and promised to give him money. And he sought an opportunity to betray him.
Thank you, Bob. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
So we're going through Mark 14, and it's obviously a really exciting and really happy story this week. It's the betrayal. And this is the best rooster I had. I can get it. If the gender's off, I understand that. But we have the rooster, and we have a betrayal from Peter, symbolized by a rooster. We have Judas's betrayal for 30 pieces of silver. And yet there's so much more in this story going on. We try to break these lessons down, you know, in Sunday school with the youth, so we go on a whole new level of deepness. And usually I never go that deep in here, because, I don't know, y'all are already sitting and tired and y'all like to fall asleep. But I ask the simple question, what do you do if somebody comes up to you with a gun to the back of your head and asks you to deny Christ? And most of us look to that question and we go, either you're one of those nerdy type, and you go, well, I've never been in that situation, and theoretically the systems would change. Okay, that's my answer. So it doesn't even work. But I got a few from that from the kids. Some of them were really smart. And then some of them gave me the good answer. Well, of course, I wouldn't deny Christ. In that situation, I would never deny Christ. If you said you will take my life, I wouldn't deny Christ. I would never betray Christ. Some of them were honest and said, I don't know that I could. I don't know that if it came down to it, that I could honestly take two in the back of the head. I don't know. And today what we're going to look at is we're going to look at these different betrayals, and I don't want you to think of them any less than us thinking of a situation where we go, what would I do if somebody was going to kill me if I refused to deny Christ? Because the truth is, I think if we're honest today, and we think about these betrayals, we're going to find ourselves in there somewhere. Because these don't involve situations where somebody goes, back of the head, you're going to die if you deny Christ. They're lesser. One is, generally, they were just asking Peter if he knew Christ, and we don't know how that would have ended. We don't know that he would have died. We don't know what would have happened if something could bad happen. Or they could have been like, yeah, tell us about him. We don't know. We have no idea. And then we have Judas, and we always look at Judas and he goes, it was about money. I bet there's a lot of us actually in that. Where we're like, we know what Christ wants from us, but we also know what that's going to cost us. And so today, I don't want you to look at these as these negative types that we can't even get close to Judas, or we can't even get close to Peter, or the apostles, or the streaking man. We have all these individuals running away and fleeing from Christ, but I want you to see that they're much more practical for us than stories of martyrdom. They're much more practical because all of us betray Christ. These betrayals are something that is part of our ladder of ascent where we draw closer to Christ. Because at one level, to say his name might cost us some money. Well, we won't do it. But then we're okay with that. And then hopefully it's a building, and so that our betrayals become less and less. Today we are in Mark chapter 14. Mark 14. Oh, we got that on. Mark 14. And we'll be starting in verse 17. And when it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they're reclining at table and eating, Jesus said, truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. They began to be sorrowful and to say to him, one after another, is it I? He said to them, it is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had never been born." Judas is one of the 12. He's breaking bread with Christ. Christ is sharing his last meal with him. It's not as though he is some fringe apostle and all the others are great and this one apostle, you know, he was kind of shut out. He was right there with Christ. He's right there dipping bread in the same cup that Jesus is, possibly sitting right next to him. And yet he tells him, "You will betray me." But he continues in verse 27, and I want you to get there's this "you're all going to betray me" concept. Mark 14, verse 27, "And Jesus said to them, 'You will all fall away. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I'm raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.' Peter said to him, 'Even though they all fall away, I will not.' Jesus said to him, 'Truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times.' But he said emphatically, 'If I must die with you, I will not deny you.' And they all said the same thing." That's where we get the idea of this. If I have to die, I would do it for Christ. And it's easy for us to sit here and go, "I would die for Christ," because the odds are you aren't going to get to. You get amazing reward for it. So that's why I say get, because Jesus says, "Blessed are those." But what I want you to see here is a different concept. We like to go, "If I had to die for you." How many of you have ever dated that pretty girl or that handsome, pretty guy? I hate the word handsome. It just sounds weird. Handsome. I don't know what it means. Beautiful guy. You got this beautiful guy, beautiful girl, whatever you got. And you're looking at him and you're like, "I would die for you because I never have to. I would give up my life." And it's like, "Yeah, really? Can I borrow that seat?" "No! Okay, just check it. Can I drive?" "Seriously? Let's talk about things that are practical here. I'm going to die for you." And that's what it is. He's like, "If I have to die for you, I won't." And we say it too. Most of us, if we are faced with the question, we're like, "We would die for Christ." And it's easy to say that because that was a theoretical situation with lots of factors that I could probably get out of. Okay. But in truth, this is what we say all the time. If I must die for Christ, I will. And yet we forget, if you ask us to speak up for him, well, that's a little much. You just said you'd die for him. But to do something little and not deny him, well, that's where I'd actually have to really think about the real situation. But he continues, and we see this in action in verse 43. "And immediately, while he was still speaking," this is after his prayer in the garden, "Judas came, one of the 12, with him. A crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, 'The one I will kiss.'" You ever notice that? Kiss. "The one I will kiss." This act of affection, this act of love, this extreme, beautiful thing. "The one I will kiss is the man." Seize him and lead him away under guard. "And when he came, he went up to him at once and said, 'Rabbi,' and he kissed him. And they laid hands on him and seized him. But one of those who stood by drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them, 'Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But let the scripture be fulfilled.' And they all left him and fled." This is where the shrieking, I'm sorry, I can't censor the Bible. "And a young man followed him with nothing but a linen cloth about him, and they seized him. But he left the linen cloth and ran away naked." This dark passage, because yes, there's Judas's betrayal, but there's Peter's. Those praying with him left him. And we sometimes forget in the middle of, you know, discussing how he dies, in the middle of discussing his torture, in the middle of discussing all this, we don't actually see any of them come back to the very end. We know the three of them come back at the very end when he's on the cross. One of them is an apostle. One of them is a ragtag, my hero, Mary Magdalene. The other is his mother. And in between, underneath all that suffering and agony, it began with a what? A kiss. This extreme betrayal of turning something holy into something unholy. Let's continue with Peter's denial. And as Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came. And seeing Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "You also were with the Nazarene Jesus." But he denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you mean." And he went out to the gateway, and the rooster crowed. And the servant girls saw him and began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again he denied it. And after a little while, the bystander again said to Peter, "Certainly you are the one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to invoke a curse on him and to swear, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." And immediately the rooster crowed a second time. And Peter remembered how Jesus had said to him, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept. A kiss for betrayal? A curse for betrayal? He curses himself to betray Christ. A rooster crows. We don't know all the motives behind what Peter did. We don't know why one moment he's saying, "You know, if I had to die for you, I would." And the next moment when he has opportunity, it's like, "I don't know that it..." Starts cursing. Gotta censor that one, church, too. Or we look at Judas and we say, "I would never do what Judas did." And we hear in this passage what Peter did. He broke down and wept. And we know from Acts what Judas does. He goes away and hangs himself and then bursts on the ground and it gets kind of gory at that point. And both of them deny Christ and are so upset about it, are so broken about it. I mean, because I love to look at Judas and I say, "I am nothing like Judas." And you know what? Most of us mean that positively. And I don't. I don't mean that positively. I sometimes would mean it more negatively. Because of the little things that I deny Christ for. The little times when I know what Christ desires of me and I know the consequences and it's just not worth it. The times when he wants me to say something or do something and I'm just like, "Do you know I'm not comfortable with that?" And I really just, I don't want Judas's response, obviously. I don't want to go hang myself. I mean, that'd be terrible. That's nasty. Somebody's got to clean that up. This is the one that I like. This is the one that I love. I want that response. I don't even start comparing myself to Peter because then I start crying before I even start. That right there. How many of us can honestly say if we betray Christ, we are broken, weeping? Christianity has become so distant from our emotions, and any abuse of emotions is always ecstasy. It's that screaming, yelling, excitement. It's never... Let's talk about mercy. Let's talk about the need for repentance. Let's talk about the need to prepare ourselves. Before we can ever celebrate what Christ has done, we prepare ourselves by being broken. I don't know if you've ever heard of Lent, the one in your belly button, not so much, but there's another kind. And it's an old church tradition, and I get that, church tradition, or whatever to y'all. But the idea is that you would spend 40 days, and you would continually reflect, and draw closer to God, and prepare yourself. So that 40 days, right? I mean, that's a long time to me. 40 days so that one day, that's it, all the way up to Holy Saturday, you would do this. Break down. Realize our need for mercy. So that then you come to Holy Saturday and you don't even eat. And then you come to the greatest day of the year, the greatest day of the week, the greatest day of all time. Pascha, Easter, Resurrection Sunday. It has a lot of names. Whatever you like. And we have removed that first part. We have removed that first part. And when we honestly say, when is the last time we were broken so much by our denial of Christ? Because I want you to notice something. Peter does not hurt Jesus. It's not like Jesus is going to the cross and Peter goes, go a little faster. It's not like he betrays him with a kiss. It's not like he hands him over to the soldiers. It's not like he's one of the soldiers doing things to him. It's not like he's a Roman betraying him. All he did was deny him. He just said, I don't know that man. I mean, he shouldn't have cursed, but generally all he's doing is saying, I don't know him. Not recognizing Christ in front of others for whatever reason. That's all he's doing. And most of us can be honest and say there's been times where we went, because we knew if we said something in line with what Christ wanted, a lot of times it's this. I always remember the biggest threat is, can I say this at work? Yeah, you can say anything you want at work. Once. Sorry, it's kind of makes sense. Right? You can't. Don't say you can't. People have probably said it before. You can say anything you want at work. Anything. Once. And the only reason that we would have God pulling on us to do the right thing and say the right thing and just take that risk, it's because we're afraid that, you know what, I might say it, and it might be my only paycheck. It might be that week where they go, well, we're going another direction. We've decided to downsize you. Hand you a pretty little card. And most of us can honestly say that we've been in a situation where it was similar to that. Where it's similar to us refusing to speak up. Maybe we don't just outright say, I don't know Christ, but we go, oh, you got problems? That's sad. You know, stuff happens. I got nothing to do for you. I got nothing to offer you. Or God wants us to do something and we are scared. I can admit, I don't like to pull over my car on the side of the road. I just have those, like, you know, movies all in my mind of, like, them pulling out of an Uzi and me ending up with holes. This is how my mind works. And so I don't really like pulling over. For anything. If I have a flat tire, I'm getting somewhere. I don't care. I'll kill that rent. And yet, did you ever get that leading? You're on a trip and you're like, man, nobody's going to stop for that. Nobody's going to stop. So you loop back after you've driven like 2 miles and now it's become a 5-minute chore, has become a 30-minute chore because you were fighting with God for the first 15. And you come back and you finally do something. And you're like, oh, I'm glad I did that. I didn't actually want to have a Swiss cheese. Or maybe you don't. A lot of times I don't. I get, you know, I fight with God long enough to be far enough away that I can then say, well, they're way back there. It would take me forever. Somebody's over there. Somebody actually stopped the first time. Yeah, it's not necessary. And I can justify and fight and, ooh, I can argue with the Holy Spirit better than I should be able to. And if we take this story of betrayal and we take it into our lives and we say this, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Help me. Help me, because I'm going to tell you one second that I will die for you, and I'm going to know that I deny you for a whole lot less. I'm going to know that there's enough betrayal in me for Christ that I may know the right thing to do, but I'm going to put it off, hopefully, until the Holy Spirit shuts up. I'm going to deny him until he quits talking. And I don't say that to say that that's everyone, but that's a lot of how we work. We can put off God long enough that he gets really quiet. And then we can deal with that. And then we just wait. God, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to make this decision to do the right thing. And I'm going to put it off 3 months. I'm going to put it off a year. I'm going to put you off long enough that you will get quiet enough that I can deal with that voice. Where sometimes we're legit and fair and we say, you know, God, well, I'll do that next week. Let me take care of God a couple months from now. And we are honest and sincere when we say it. And then a couple weeks come and we realize that pressure's not as bad now. That pressure to actually obey Christ is not as extreme. So we're left with this beautiful ending to Mark, but I don't know. Some have tried to destroy Martin Luther. But I want you to hear these words. And this is that one that we put off. We did not. And he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Protestants did a great job with this verse. They actually removed it from most Bibles. Have you noticed it's bracketed? It's like, please rip this out because it really makes me uncomfortable. They didn't do it with Matthew, so we still have the Great Commission, but not this one. We have this one, and it tells us, and it's very simple. I mean, is there another way to deny Christ? Yes. Is this one pretty true to us, though? Right here, it's pretty clear. It says, go into the world and preach the gospel to all creation. I don't know. What's the reason? Does it go back to the money, or does it go back to roosters? Roosters couldn't get any of them. What is it in your life that you would honestly say, if I was put to a gun, why is that even a question? I deny him when you say, be honest on your taxes. Give to Caesar what is due Caesar. Y'all know it's tax season. And you're like, you know what? He doesn't have to know about that income. That was on the side. It was in paper money. Doesn't count. Or that time when you're at work and you're like, well, you know what? I might get in trouble for saying something. And it may be the greatest blessing to the person they have ever been given. And you know what? This may not be it, and I'm not telling you this is exactly what God has put on your heart to do with someone, but I'm telling you this, that God doesn't want us to be Christians. To be Christians. He wants us to live Christ. He wants us to live Him. He wants us to live for our Lord. And the crazy thing is, we have really tried to make secret Christianity the go-to, right? Let me make Jesus as simple as possible. And so what do? We cut down an invitation to seven little things. I don't like them. I don't. And you know why I don't like them? Because God doesn't say, I want a response today. He says, I want your life. He doesn't say, I want a response when it's easy and everybody's going to cheer and clap. He wants a response when everybody's going to boo and hiss. He wants you to be a Christian Monday morning. He wants you to be a Christian when your football team loses. I got somebody out there. He wants you to be a Christian all those other times. Not be a Christian as in say something and do something and this one day you respond. And then live however you want. The truth is, if you live however you want, but you made that decision, you have wasted a lot of time. God has a place prepared for those who do not know Him or keep His commandments. So if we're going to make the confession and all that, but we're not going to live for Him, don't waste time. Because God offers us so much. And we can betray Him, and that's fine. Peter betrays Him. All the apostles betray Him. Everybody does. But can we respond the way He does? With brokenness. The invitation today is that brokenness. Can we respond to God with a brokenness that says we are willing to be broken by Him? We'll discuss how to do that if you come forward. But the thing is, we have an invitation today to discuss how to be broken. We also have an invitation for those who need prayers. And if you want to submit to the eldership here, you can respond out of that too. As we stand and as we sing.